Forgive me. Forgive me, forgive me. All right. No, no. Let me steal a chair here. Do me a favor, if we can. Well, you may not need to, but I was going to say pull up some, but I'll just pull up to you. I'll just sit right here. How's that? And we are supposed to be in Revelation chapter 6. But three times the Lord spoke something different to me. And so I feel like we need to obey the Lord and go into something different. This is hot chocolate, by the way. Anybody want a glass of hot chocolate? There's plenty of it here. You want some hot chocolate? Yeah. Here. I'll tell you what. I'll go around and I'll tell you what we're doing and I'll give you... Take a cup. There you go. There you push. Anybody else want some hot chocolate? It's good stuff. You don't have to be scared of it. Now, I had originally made two pots of it. This is not what we usually do in here, just so you know, brother. Yeah, push it, hold it down. I got you. Yeah, pump it, pump it. Josh? But I'd originally made two. Jason and I were in the kitchen earlier, and I don't know if you've ever heard of someone blowing up an air pot, but one exploded. It literally exploded. I hope that wasn't yours, Brandy. But, I mean, it went off like a shotgun. Does it? It was the weirdest thing. Glass went all over the place. Now, there's no glass in this. So you don't have to be afraid of this, okay? So here's what I'm going to do. Anybody else want some hot chocolate? We got a little couple minutes here. And it's good hot chocolate. If you're cold, trust me, you want some hot chocolate because... It's warm. This is Swiss Miss. No, you can't beat that.
All right. Thank you.
Tom, you want some hot chocolate?
It's not every day you get to do this. So.
Anybody else? Don't be scared. Don't be like, you know what? I'm going to be the spiritual one tonight that protests this vile act in the middle of our service of handing out hot chocolate. This isn't like some modern compromise for communion. This
Jesus
is
never said drink hot chocolate.
Yeah. Anybody else? Pam, you're wanting a hot chocolate, aren't you? Okay.
Better watch out, Mom.
See, we'll serve everybody in here hot chocolate within about 5 minutes. And the people in the yeah. Right.
How do you do this?
Well, see, the difference is you don't got to pay for this, so.
Thank you, by the way.
You're welcome.
Cool, thank you.
Yeah, anybody else before I put it up? Because I'll sit here and drink the rest of it. There are some marshmallows up there. Yeah, there actually are. Anybody want marshmallows in their hot chocolate? Yeah, yeah, just grab a few. You know, hopefully everybody had clean hands. I mean, you touch, you know. Yeah, I mean, if you've ever had hot chocolate as a connoisseur, it's like, you know, the... Marshmallows are what kind of set it off. So, anybody else? Marshmallows in their hot chocolate? No? Anybody just want to eat a handful of marshmallows? All right. So I got some in mine, and then this is not going to take a whole lot of time, but it wouldn't be right. It wouldn't be just right without some Oreo cookies. Now it's really like Bridge Point, huh? So somebody who's got some fingernails, you can just, well, look at that, I did it, okay? You can just pass these around. You know, usually we don't like to eat in here, but if you want, you know, some cookies, pass them around. Now, when I was in prison, we had fake Oreos. They were called Duplex. And they did something the Oreo makers don't do. They made a lemon duplex. And there ain't nothing like that lemon duplex. That's really what I wanted. But Oreo tried to answer that with what they call the golden Oreo. So if you want a golden Oreo, you can just kind of pass those around. Pass the plate. Nobody's asking for money. That's really good. Praise God. Wow. What a blessing. All right, well, praise the Lord, man. Turn your Bible to Luke chapter 8. Mm-hmm. Well. Luke. Luke chapter 8. I got a lawn chair back there too, but you think I'm joking? I actually do, don't I, Jason? It's like a beach chair or something. I just, it's not as comfortable as it's supposed to be. Ah, Father, we give you praise. We thank you for your mercy and love. Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for who you are. Lord Jesus, I thank you so much that you didn't get up each morning and show consistency in anything but your character. Lord, everything you did it differently. You understood, Lord, that to be led by the Spirit meant that you couldn't replicate day after day what had worked the day before. When you touched the blind man and when you put your fingers into the ears of a deaf woman, Lord, when you spoke resurrection over a little girl, when you calmed the seas and the waves, when you rebuked the Pharisees, when you drove out the money changers from the temple, Lord, none of these things had been done before. You were led by the Spirit. You were fully God, and yet you'd become fully man, and you laid aside your prerogative to act as God, and you showed us what it was to be led by the Holy Spirit. Lord, we live our lives trying to replicate things that have worked in the past. We compare ourselves with one another. We compare ourselves with men who have lived good lives, with women who have raised good families and been good wives. And Lord, we fall short. Things don't happen for us, Lord, like they happen for others, and we wonder why. We're confused by it. Though we've done the same things, followed, Lord, the same recipe, things don't turn out the same, and we wonder why. Lord, your plan for each one of us is unique. Your calling upon each one of us is unique. Your Spirit's leadership in each one of us is unique. The only thing that's consistent is your character, your holiness, your faithfulness. You'll never break your commitment to us. We praise you for that. Thank you, Lord, for that freedom. That's the real freedom. To be free of having to cram ourselves into somebody else's mold. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to do that, God. That there isn't, Lord, for us as a church, anything that we've got to attain to this year except what your Spirit says we're to attain to. There isn't anything that we have to attain to as individuals this year, God, except what your Spirit says that we have to attain to. Thank you, Lord, that we don't have to follow somebody else's pattern. We only have to walk in your Spirit. I praise you for that freedom. Those that you set free, Lord, they're free indeed. Lord, I praise you. You not made us free to sin, Lord, but you made us free to serve one another in love, and Lord, that's what we want to do. So be with us tonight and open your word, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. So Luke chapter 8, three times in the last week or two, when I was filled with some kind of anxiety, you know, you get filled with it sometimes, you can't even quite lay your finger on why. Worry, some kind of inner anxiety. You don't even always understand it. You can figure it out if you really try to trace it down usually, but even then sometimes life just mounts up, you know, expectations unfulfilled, or in the name of meeting an expectation, you're working feverishly trying to get things done, and it's too much. You know, it's like you're stacking up blocks with a goal of reaching the ceiling, but every block you stack, there's four or five more blocks of responsibility that demand that they get stacked too, and you can't keep track of it. It's too much. So just in those types of feelings coming and going, you know, a periodic lapse into a depression, you can't always understand it. Just comes over and you're like, man, why do I feel this way? You try to trace it back to something. It might even be traceable, but sometimes it's not even that big a deal. But the way it's impacted you is big. The way it makes you feel is big. And the Lord three times spoke a verse to me. I wasn't even sure if it was in the Bible. I literally was just not even sure if it was in the Bible. I thought at first that I had twisted two different texts and put them together. I had remembered Romans chapter 2, verse 17, where Paul says that for those who patiently continue in doing well, they would receive honor, glory, and immortality. And I thought I had mixed that scripture with another scripture. I thought, man, what God is speaking to me, and I'll tell you what it was in a minute, is not even, I'm not even sure it's in the Bible. But three times throughout that week and a half or so period, out of the blue, he just whispered to me by the Holy Spirit, you'll bear fruit with patience. You'll bear fruit with patience. And it was in moments where you're thinking about, where I'm thinking about all that has to be done. There's a lot to be done. All of us have, you know, things that we list out in our mind, want to see accomplished in the name of making our lives meaningful, in the name of making an impact. And these things can just fill you with anxiety. You've already got the anxieties that everyone wrestles with, like health and family, financial security and things like that. But then if you're a believer, there's another kind of anxiety. There's the cares of the kingdom of God. But even that sometimes can mount up on us in a way that is not right. God would not have us to bear it the way that we often feel it on us, where it gets heavy. And I think all Christians experience that at some point, where you believe God has called you to something. You may not even know exactly what it is, but you believe that you've got an idea. And you see time slipping by, and you grow concerned that you're no closer to that thing than you were maybe months prior, maybe years prior. And so you become anxious inside, and you want to start to do things and make plans, and you step out, and a lot of times you get ahead of God when you do that. Sometimes you stay on the path, but you begin to perceive it in a way that God never intended. You begin to perceive it as burdensome. And however many things that there may be for us to do before we actually stand in our God-given right of ministry and calling, the more we look at those things in detail and the more burdensome they become and the longer it seems that they will take to accomplish before we can stand in that place that God has called us to, it can just be overwhelming. And you can get to where you just feel overwhelmed. You know, and I think all believers, all true believers, can say that this is true for them, that they want to bear fruit. And if you're a true believer, you don't just want to bear fruit. You want to be awesome. You want to make an impact. You want to be like we'll read in a minute in this parable. You want to bear some 30, some 60, and really you just want to bear 100-fold fruit. You want to be useful to God. You want to go down in a blaze of glory. You want to hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant." You want to do things no one else has done for the King of Glory. He deserves it. You're seeking, as Romans 2 incidentally says, honor and glory and immortality in a godly sort of way. But we look around and we see Charles Spurgeon. We look around, or, you know, we read or we listen and we hear about John Wesley or Catherine Booth, William Booth's wife, for those of you who don't know, better preacher than he was. Or we hear the stories of what other even modern day Christian phenomenons are, other countries, you know. And we'll tend to say things to the Lord like, you know, "Lord, why aren't you replicating that in my life? I've done the things that Spurgeon did. I've done the things that Wesley did. Why aren't you replicating the result? Or I've done the thing that his wife has done and my husband is still not happy. I've done the thing that that mother has done and my children still have turned out to be drug addicts or still are not well behaved or still seemingly have no desire for Christ. Why did you not replicate for me what I see done for others?" And the reality is, God would say to us that he has an amazing plan for the believer that differs for every single one of us. You can never be Charles Spurgeon, because what God has called you to is far superior than simply being what somebody else was meant to be. Amen. See how beneath glory that would be? To have as your greatest potential only to become like some other man. Jesus is the ultimate goal. Amen. That's what we strive toward. And when you see Jesus, it's so different. I mean, and there's so much. John said if he had written it all down, the books would be, there wouldn't be enough room in the world to contain the books. Talk about a busy guy, but busy doing all of the right things, all of those things that he was led to do by the Spirit of God's prompting. In prayer before the Father, hearing, receiving wisdom, and then walking it out. Never growing too anxious that if he didn't get enough done that day, that if he didn't accomplish A, B, and C before the sun fell that evening, that somehow he would be behind. Jesus was never behind. Those who are led by the Spirit of God, they're never behind. They don't fall behind. Even what seems like falling behind isn't really falling behind. It's only the providence of God. Hindrances that God allows for the one who's walking in the Spirit, they're not even really hindrances. They're promotions. They accelerate you down the path of God's will, but when the perception is not there, you can't see it that way, you can't hear it that way. And so many times we look at the thing that God has ultimately called us to, or at least what we think God has ultimately called us to, and because we can't get in the moment that God has called us to, we end up being unfaithful in the moment. And we believe a lie. And the lie is that if the ultimate thing came, there we would be faithful, though where we're at now, we are not faithful. The one who's faithful in little is faithful in much. To the one who has, who's holding on to what he has, the little bit he's been given, more shall be given. But to the one who does not have, the Bible says, even what he seems to have, and the word seems in the Greek is even what he thinks he has, will be taken away from him. You can't race past the will of God for your life. You can only surrender to it. Timing is of God. It's all of God. You cannot race past it. You can only surrender to it. If you fight it, you become ineffective, and then you get weighted down with unnecessary burdens. You begin to grow confused. You begin to doubt whether or not God has called you to what you thought he called you to after all. And pretty soon you end up depressed. And then you stand back up and go after it again and maybe even make a little bit of progress in a mad dash toward what you perceive to be your call. But you cannot lay hold of what you've been laid hold of for that way. You can only walk in step with the Spirit and get to the place where God's Spirit would have you to be. There is no fast track, as it were, in the kingdom of God. There is only God's track. Apparently faster for some, apparently slower for others. I heard Brother Tim from Brooklyn Tabernacle teach a message recently on Joseph. He's been teaching a lot on Joseph, but one of the things that he noted in his study that was consistent not only with Joseph, but with many other men and women of God, was that it seemed that the longer the men and women of God had to wait to stand in their God-given right of ministry and place, the more powerful it was. Those who rush past it always end up losing out. But the good thing is that even if we've done that, because most all of us have done that, if you're a Christian and have any desire to please the Lord, that the gifts and callings of God are irrevocable. Amen. They're without repentance. It means that you can start over right now. His mercies are new every morning. So let me read through and just see if there's anything to pull out of this. And we'll get to the verse that actually is in the Bible, by the way, in the middle of this. Luke chapter 8. Now it came to pass afterward that he went through every city and village preaching and bringing the glad tidings of the kingdom of God, and 12 were with him. And certain women who had been healed of evil spirits and diseases, Mary called Magdalene, out of whom 7 demons had come, and Joanna the wife of Chuza, Herod's steward, and Susanna, and many others who provided for him from their possessions. He's with a bunch of derelicts. We think about the 12 and they know they were fishermen and all of that stuff and roughkins. But the women that are with him, I think they might even be worse. They were all ex-demon-possessed harlots, basically. And when a great multitude had gathered, but see, you know, the point here, I think, is, oh my goodness, Son of God leaves heaven, comes to earth, and looks who he chooses to go with him. The most unlikely, the most really, unqualified, at least by human perspective. And when a great multitude had gathered and they had come to him from every city, he spoke by a parable. He said, a sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trampled down, and the birds of the air devoured it. Some fell on rock, as soon as it sprang up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. And some fell on thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it. But others fell on good ground, sprang up, and yielded a crop 100-fold. And when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice, is the sense behind that word. He cried. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Not everybody can hear. And in one sense, it's almost as simple. The reason for that, it's almost as simple as this. They won't slow down long enough to hear. Yeah, the heart is the problem. The heart is hard. But because of the hardness of heart, they will not slow down to really hear what the Lord's saying. And the believer can be so like that. The believer can be like that. I mean, all people are like, but the believer can even be like that, to where he's in his mad dash rushing toward the thing that he has made the icon of his life in terms of ministry in the kingdom of God. And in his rush toward it, he will not slow down long enough to sit with Jesus and to hear the Holy Spirit. You know, that is what the little thing here is for. You know, because sometimes I'll approach this as if, and I'll probably keep on doing this, but as if, man, not 30 seconds to spare. You know, but there is, and it's a discipline for me. I have to constantly, and especially over this last year and a half, but I have to constantly slow down and check to see if the Holy Spirit has been saying something to me that I may not have been listening to. Did I miss something you were saying a few steps back? Lord, please tell me. I'm sitting down now listening. And so he shouts this out because he really does want people to hear. To him that has ears to hear, let him hear. And then his disciples asked him, saying, what does this parable mean? And he said, to you it's been given to know the mysteries, the secret hidden truths of the kingdom of God, but to the rest, who are the rest? Those that will not hear, do not have ears to hear. They hear, but they don't. To the rest it's given in parables, seeing, and he quotes the Old Testament prophet Isaiah, seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand. God knew it would be like this because of the hardness of heart. Now, the parable is this. The seed is the Word of God. He establishes that. That's very important. What we need to hear is the Word of God. That's what we need to hear. I cannot tell you how often the Holy Spirit, when He speaks things to me, they are direct quotes from the Bible that sometimes I have to go look and I'm like, where did that come from? Because it's not like a verse. Maybe it's two words. Or it's just so consistent with all of the Word of God. What we have to hear is the Word of God. He says the seed is the Word of God. Those by the wayside are the ones who hear. They do hear. Then the devil comes and takes away the Word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. So the Word falls on the heart, but it cannot penetrate even superficially. The devil immediately comes because it lays there right for the taking, like a vicious bird steals it. Verse 13, but the one on the rock are those who, when they hear too, receive the word with joy. And these have no root, who believe for a while and in time of temptation, the word in the Greek there is also testing, fall away. So these have no root. There's an initial, very superficial hearing that takes place. Yeah, man, I hear that. Yeah, I hear it. I gotcha. But it doesn't really. The Word of God is the seed, and the seed begins to put these roots out, right? But it says here it really has no root, and the idea is it has no ability to root. It can't get down inside there, because it's just a superficial depth that's available to it. And so it, when the sun comes out, when trials come, isn't sucking up the kind of nutrients and life that is demanded that you must have in order to face a trial, in order to get scorched. And all who hear and receive the word of God will get scorched. The devil will come by, and if he sees the seed has sunk past the superficial depth, knows that the sun is coming out, because God himself will test you and he's going to tempt you. And you'll be tested in the temptation, both together. One end the devil, the other end God. There for you, with you. But if your heart is still hard, it's only a superficial availability to God. And so they're scorched, verse 14. Now the ones that fell among thorns are those who, when they have heard, go out and are choked with cares, and the word is anxieties, riches, and pleasures of life. And look, it doesn't say they don't bring forth fruit. It says they bring no fruit to maturity. See, these are even a step further. They spring up. There's even a bit more than a superficial depth. The roots can get down a little bit. The problem is the seeds of anxieties are sending their roots out. The seeds of the desire for financial stability, security, job security, future security, these things, the cares of this life. What that is. The desire for pleasures as well. Not, it doesn't say sinful pleasure. It's not debauchery here. This is a vacation. This is my bigger house. This, yes, the cares, the concerns, the anxieties for that, like seeds germinate in the heart, send out roots, and the Word of God will not share a heart with these things. God has made the seed of His Word such that it will only prosper in a heart unshared. And so if the roots of anxieties and the cares of this life and all of these things are there in that heart, because they would not be eradicated by the breaking up of fallow ground, which is repentance. That's all that is. Because the ground would not be tilled. The tiller came through, the Lord Jesus willing to grant repentance, it would not receive it. So it's just a superficial thing there. The great depth that needed to be broken up, and this garbage is in there, these weeds, and they begin to choke out the life, and so the fruit dies on the branch. It never reaches maturity so that it can be partaken of. How many of you would say, you know what, I'd love to be just filled with fruit galore, but if I could just be that, I'd be fine if it never actually came to maturity. I just look real good. That's what the lives of a lot of Christians will end up being proved to have been. Massive from the appearance fruit, but never quite coming to maturity where the farmer would come down, the one who sows the seed and delight in partaking of it. So the well done never comes. The fruit that delights the heart of God never comes. Verse 16, almost as if it were disconnected, but he doesn't stop. No one, when he's lit a lamp, covers it with a vessel or puts it under a bed, but sets it on a lampstand that those who enter may see the light. The intention of God in doing what He has done, lighting us, is that we would shine and that people would see His glory through us, that we would bear fruit. His intention is He intentionally works in us with the purpose that you and I would bring forth fruit to maturity, would be glorifying Him with our lives. God wants every single Christian to bring glory to Him. There isn't one saved individual, one born-again person that God's plan for is like this. You know what? This one here really just going to have to struggle and not bring me really any glory on this earth. Nobody's going to see their light shine. I just want them to kind of suffer through a bunch of hidden fruit. No, Jesus is telling us what the Father is like and what He's purposed. He's like, I came to light you because I want to stick you right out in front of everybody so that you will light it up. And people, as a result of you, will begin to see you'll bring glory to me. That's the Father's intention. But then He says, for nothing is secret that will not be revealed, nor anything hidden that will not be known and come to light. You know, and the reality here is you simply cannot be hidden, number one, forever if you have the life of God in you. If the seed is germinated and the roots are growing deep down into good, nutritious soil of repentance, a repentant heart, what God has done within you will not be hidden. It will be seen. It will come out of you. But contrarywise, if it isn't a repentant heart, if the ground is hard, if the work of God is being frustrated and disallowed, that too will be revealed. Therefore, verse 18, take heed how you hear, tying what He's just now said to the parable. And His loud cry to him who has ears, let him hear. Take heed, therefore, because of this, because of what I just told you, take heed how you hear. For whoever has, to him more will be given, and whoever does not have, even what he seems to have, what he thinks he has, will be taken away. Now, verse 19, it seems disconnected too. Verse 19, then his mother and brothers came to him and could not approach him because of the crowd. What was the crowd doing there? It was standing there listening. There was a multitude that had gathered, back up verse 4, chapter 8, standing there listening. Takes the disciples aside, privately gives them this little communicata, but not outside of the multitude. Crowd still there, peeking in, trying to listen in. And because of the crowd blocking his mother and brothers, they can't get to him. And verse 20 says, it was told to him by some who said, your mother and brothers are standing outside desiring to see you. Now look what he does. He will not let himself be interrupted by this. Because he's making a point, he's teaching something vital. And he's not going to stop, because I fully believe this is satanic. Not that the devil is in Mary using Mary, but I believe that he's using the circumstance. He's lining it up. The brothers at this point were not believing that Jesus was the Messiah. And Mary, so far as we know, was still just treasuring these things up in her heart. Doesn't mean she wasn't a believer. She knew she was the mother of the Lord in that sense. But I believe the devil uses this, tries to just stop this thing, and look what he does. Turns it right around. And he answered verse 21 and said, my mother and brothers are these who, what? There it is again, hear. He's not going to stop. He's like, I'm in the middle of preaching. I'm teaching. That's great, but let me tell you something. And he moves right back into it. My mother and brothers are those who hear the word of God, but there's something else. And they don't just hear the word of God, because otherwise, you know, there'd be every single example that we just read about in the parable. No, my mother and brothers are those who hear. See, his brothers were hearing. They weren't doing anything. Many of the people in the crowd were hearing. They're hearing all kind of things. You and I are hearing all kind of things. And sometimes I have to wonder, why isn't it taking effect in you? Why isn't what you're hearing Sunday after Sunday, Wednesday after Wednesday, iPod message after iPod message, download after download, book after book, and with me too? I'll class myself in there, because at times I could say that about myself, but I have to ask, why? What is the reason, God, why it just seems in some people, not take any effect? Well, the answer is because you, in those moments, are like this crowd. You hear superficially. There's a hardness beneath the surface. And you will not allow God to break it up. Put simply, you refuse to repent of the sin that's in your life. You refuse to repent of the sin. What, pornography? No, not necessarily. Your agenda, your plan, your track that you have laid out, identified, and the plan that you have to go down it and get to where you want to be. The moment that you set your goals, and those goals are not reflective of the will of God, you need to repent. And if you choose not to repent, you will grow hard of hearing. You will lose your spiritual hearing. There's no drinking, there's no cussing, there's no pornography, there's no lying, there may not even be being mean to people sometimes because you're just that personality who's like Mary Poppins. But you are a vile wretch that is in rebellion as a Christian, no less than the guy who has walked away into a saloon, a bar, pornography, prostitution, whatever it might be, adultery. And so you will begin to lose your hearing. And the only way that you can gain it back is to let, in a moment of sitting down, just sit down for a minute. Let the Holy Spirit tell you what you have not been willing to hear. And when you hear it, do it. Obey it. Repent of it. They hear the word of God and do it. Verse 22, now it happened on a certain day that he got into a boat with his disciples and he said to them, let's cross over to the other side of the lake. And they launched out, but as they sailed, he fell asleep. And a windstorm came down on the lake and they were filling with water and were in jeopardy. They were in danger. So what happens? How are they going to respond to it? Because everybody gets scorched. Everybody gets trials. He just got done teaching them, and now here they get one. They get a trial. This is a good opportunity just to freak out. Or it's a good opportunity to have heard the word of God and now believe it, obey it, put it into practice. So let's see what they do. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, Master, Master, we're perishing. They're freaking out. They're completely losing their grasp on everything that they've heard. The circumstance is bigger than their faith. They've heard all that they ever needed to hear, but it's only gone down so deep. And these were not men who were good and noble soil at this point. Jesus was working with him, and he'll work with us. But he had to tell Peter, when, you know, you're going to deny me three times. And when you're converted, when there's a change that comes about, what did he do? He repented. He was broken. Something got broken up in there so that the word of God could get down in deeper. I know some are thinking, well, this is like a salvation parable. Not fully. There's much more to this than that. This is really about bearing fruit. That's what it's about. Bringing glory, letting your light shine, showing your faith in circumstances where when it is shown, man, people are like, he believes in God. So here they freak out. Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the raging of the water, and they ceased, and there was a calm. But he said to them, where is your faith? So God has planned the whole thing out. I'm going to teach them some things. I want them to hear some things. Then I'm going to bring a circumstance in. And this is the test. How will you respond to it? You miserably failed. Where is your faith? Where is it? We left it back there where you told us about it, and we were like, yeah! We received it, Annan, with joy. Right? The disciples, have you ever thought about that? They don't look like the fourth soil. In this case, they look like the ones who, I mean, think about their whole ministry. They look like, I mean, Judas is not, I mean, he's just gone. But look at the rest of them. You know, they wanted him to go in, sit down on the throne in Jerusalem, and set them up on thrones sitting next to him. And when they realized he wasn't what Peter denied him, they all left him. You'll all forsake me this night. Right? One guy, craziest thing, the book of John includes it, Mark, evidently the John Mark who writes the Gospel of Mark, who would later become known as a more prominent follower of Jesus, is with those disciples. The strangest thing, this guy is running away naked. And you wonder, like, you know, why exactly is that, you know, things. But the one thing that you know when you look at the disciples, these don't look like fourth soil guys. But they do turn out to be that. Because they get this. Jesus wants them to hear this, and now he teaches them with an object lesson. Many times God will give you something. He will give you something. Yeah, he's giving it to you. And if you possess it, if you're like, man, I'm holding on to this. I'm not letting this go. No matter what comes, I'm going to hold on to it. He's going to bring something where that will be tested. And Amen. A lot of the times we let it go. But in those times when we don't let it go, what peace there is. When God gave us something, then the storm comes in the boat where, you know, Jesus is sleeping. He's drinking hot chocolate with marshmallows on the back. That's, again, the whole. But he's unfazed by the thing. But they just freak out. They don't possess it. But God is so gracious, he'll give you chance after chance after chance. So it says here that he said, where is your faith? And they were afraid and marveled, saying to one another, who can this be? For he commands even the winds and water, and they obey him. And see, that's the awesome thing. Like, what we get is capable of relieving me from anxiety. Three times the Holy Spirit said this to me. Verse 15. But the ones that fell on the good ground are those who, having heard the word with a noble and good heart, keep it, and this phrase, bear fruit with patience. He said to me, bear fruit with patience. Timing is of God. Timing is of God. Galatians, do not grow weary in well-doing, for in due season you shall reap if you do not faint. Psalms 1, blessed is the man who doesn't walk in the counsel of the ungodly, stand in the way of the sinner, seat in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in it he meditates, day and night he ponders, he talks with himself about what the word of God, the seed, says. And he's like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that brings forth his fruit in season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. Promises from God. New Testament, you will reap if you don't give up. Old Testament, you will bring forth fruit in season. Your leaves will not wither. Whatever you do will prosper. Joshua, only be thou of good courage, and you will make your way prosperous. No man stood before Joshua in his entire life. face-to-face in that sense. They had the thing with AI and God dealt with them over sin. These are the promises of God for the believer, for the Christian. You and I have the promise that we will all bear fruit to maturity. We will all bring massive glory to God. But it will be with patience. Anxieties that send down those roots that compete and fight with the Word of God have to be repented of, moved aside. We have to slow down if we're in the mad dash and sit at the feet of Jesus and hear and ask, have I missed something that you said to me? Have I gone a few steps ahead? What have I ignored? Have I gone after what has the luster on it, not realizing that it's just getting me sidetracked? Bear fruit with patience. Yes, but you know, this ministry or that guy or this girl, man, it was like, you know, 3 months. And then, you know, after 3 months, it was like, you know, the whole, like Australia was worshiping that person. In comparing yourselves with one another, you are not wise. Even here, don't compare yourselves with one another. Don't compare our church with another church. Don't compare me with somebody else. Don't do it. It's not wise. The apostles would not do it. 2 Corinthians 10:12. Paul said, we will not do that. And these false apostles in doing that, he says they're without understanding. That's what the Greek says. They don't understand. God has an amazing individual commitment that he's made to each one of you. You are going to produce fruit. I can't explain how much comfort that gives me. Because, I can get up and I can pray. And this is what I pray every morning. Before I'm even out of the bed, I pray it. Father, show me what to do today. Now, I know I have things that I have to do like all of us do. There's things I have to do, but what I mean goes far beyond that. Father, show me what you want me to do today. Show me what you want me to do. And out of the stupidest things come the greatest things. Like going to get the hot chocolate. I went to Walgreens. And it just so happened that right when I pulled up at Walgreens, there was a Hindu family stranded on the sidewalk waiting for a taxi cab. So that turned out to be a pretty cool opportunity that blessed me in the Lord. Later, because I stayed here a little longer than I should, blowing up a coffee pot and stuff, I met a guy from next door outside and got to talk with him for a little bit. When you walk in the pace that the Holy Spirit sets, you will end up in places and among people that in your pace you will never meet. You'll have experiences that in your pace you'll never have. And that's why we have to be led by the Holy Spirit. You'll bear fruit with patience. Be patient with God, persevere, endure with God. Wrestle, but hold on. And be patient with yourselves in the sense that don't give up. In the sense that Paul said to the Galatians, don't give up. Don't grow weary. Realize that Jesus loves you so much and has a specific love and intent for you. I felt like the Lord said to me, don't be anxious, don't worry, don't be afraid. I've got a perfect plan for you. It'll come when the time is right. Until then, hold on to what you have. Be faithful where you are. Be patient. Don't be overwhelmed with all that needs to be done and the little time that's left. Just trust me and I'll do it. That's what the Lord has been speaking to me, and I felt like he wanted me to share that with you. There's some other things that we could share, but I'll just leave you with one story, and then Drew, if you would come up and close us in some worship. I am ridiculous when it comes to rushing around at a mad dash. Ridiculous. Have you ever seen the show Fire Marshal Bill? Dude, I'm telling you, God has made me that guy. Yeah. I'll give you an example. Last week, I'm driving home. I don't want to disappoint my wife. I've left here a little bit late. And I know that there's a 15-minute zone that if I'm on the wrong side of, it will not be good. I want to be on the right side of that 15 minutes. You know, because your wife whittles it up. You're later than you really are. And you whittle it down. So I'm speeding. And I'm hitting every roadblock. I realize 49th's got a roadblock. Now I'm going over to the right. Now it decides to start raining cats and dogs. So I'm fighting creation at this point. And literally, without me saying it, I have challenged it to a duel. So I run a red light in the middle of the rain, you know, just barely where your butt goes through the red light. And right then, the Lord said to me, "Now you know, since you did that, you're going to get there much later than you planned to." And I actually, I thought it was comical because God has taught me this lesson so many times that I said, "Lord, what are you going to do to me this time?" And literally, what are you going to do to me this time? I was in LKQ, the junkyard, about 2 years ago, and I was hurrying, I was rushing. I'd busted my knuckle trying to get a auto part out of something. Then it started raining on me. Finally, I find what I need, and in my exhaustion, because I'm running around like a chicken with my head cut off, I fall back into the fence in the rain, which is 7,000 volts of electricity on their interior of their fence. So I thought I was dead, like my heart stopped and came back. That's why I said Fire Marshal Bill. So I'm riding in this van and I'm like, "God, what are you going to do to me?" And I'm just waiting because I know it's going to happen and it's not going to be anything that happens to normal people. So I hit a big puddle. All of a sudden a van sounds like it exploded. What happens? The exhaust system falls off and now I'm dragging it down the road. I stop, get out to look at it. I can't keep going because instead of it falling down at the back of the van, it held at the back of the van and fell down in the middle. So to keep going, I'm just going to run it over and smash it or drive in reverse. So I have to get out in all the rain, climb up under the van, take some wires off another place, wire up this place, burn the dog snot out of my arm, which just now has healed, and finally I make it home. And I just walk in the door, you know. And, dude, how long is it going to take me to learn this lesson? I'm so stubborn. But that is how ridiculous it is when God has made us these amazing promises that if we're patient, that if we're steadfast, that if we're immovable, that if we're obedient, that if we just seek His face, stop to listen, and then do what He says, it will be radical and it will be exhausting. But He will replenish us and He will fill us and He will restore us and we will be filled with peace and we'll be filled with joy. And it won't be like, "Man, I'm the stupidest man on the planet" type of stuff. So let's just worship for a minute. Thank God. And if you are that person filled with anxiety, you're running your own race. It's not the one that was set before you either. You set it before you. Not the one the Lord called you to. You're not even being faithful here. I don't mean in the building. God's not going to use you anywhere else. Be faithful where you're at. Let's stand and worship God. Kneel.
To bring peace, to be loved. to us you come to bring light, to be light, to shine brighter in us so we let you. To come.